due to herbicide resistance, many growers have run out of a lot of knockdown chemistries and are having to look more at pre-emergence to fill the gap. There's a few issues that can occur when you're using pre-emergent herbicides, and a lot of this is happening at sowing. So what we've done is we've looked at a range of tillage and sowing implements and how they've performed in different stubble and soil situations, and evaluated how they've performed.
In the southern and western grains regions, growers have been using pre-emergent herbicides as a significant component of weed management in winter crops for some time. By comparison, many northern region growers still rely on post-emergent herbicides. However, as the number of herbicide-resistant weed populations increases, there's a growing realisation that the farming system must change. Increased reliance on pre-emergent herbicides is one component of farming system change. While residual herbicides can help maintain a profitable farming system, potential downside issues need to be managed. Issues such as recropping limitations, crop safety, and weed control at sowing when residual herbicides are used with different types of seeding equipment. To obtain the best possible performance from pre-emergent herbicides, it's critical to know how they work and understand how to manage the risks surrounding herbicide efficacy and selectivity to emerging crops. In recent years, crop damage resulting from the use of pre-emergent herbicides has been experienced when the seeder travels too fast and treated soil is thrown into adjoining crop rows, the seeding depth is too shallow, the seed slot is not closed properly, or when there's heavy rain after sowing. Grass herbicides applied prior to winter cereals can be used safely and effectively. To explain how most of the pre-emergent herbicides used for grass control in cereals work, here's International Authority on Herbicide and Soil Interaction, Dale Shaner, explaining what can happen using peroxisulfone as an example.
These herbicides are taken up primarily through the shoots as the shoot emerges. And if you have seed that's fairly shallow so that the herbicide can get to the seed before it starts emerging, you'll get much more injury under those circumstances because the seed's trying to germinate and send up its coleoptile in the presence of high concentration of the herbicide. So that's, we've found that you can get increased injury under those circumstances. So for example, if you have a very light soil and you have a heavy rainfall right after planting or prior to the plant coming, the wheat coming up, you can find that the peroxisulfone can move down into that seed zone and actually cause more injury under those circumstances than if it was a heavier soil and the herbicide remains above the seed so that the coleoptile can actually get through. You just don't want the growing points to be exposed to the herbicide.
Some key pre-emergent herbicides used at sowing for grass weed control in winter crops include triolate, trifluralin, S-metolachlor and prosulfocarb, the actives in Boxer Gold, propizamide, and peroxisulfone. Triolate and trifluralin are considered volatile and may be subject to large volatility losses if not incorporated or covered with soil soon after application. With a single pass pre-seeding in a no-till paddock, it's likely a tined equipment will be needed and require sowing speed, soil condition and row spacing to be in balance so soil displaced from the crop row is thrown into the inter-row and not into adjoining crop rows where a concentration of herbicide-treated soil would increase the likelihood of crop damage. Displacing treated soil from the crop row during the seeding process also relocates most of the weed seed into the inter-row area. However, weed seed remaining in the untreated soil left in the crop row may still germinate, especially in the case of non-mobile herbicides such as trifluralin. To visually demonstrate how different types of planting equipment move surface-applied herbicide, urea and gypsum were spread to simulate a layer of herbicide applied before sowing.
Well, here we are on Windy Station in the Liverpool Plains, and we've got some prilled urea that we've put down to emulate pre-emergent herbicide on the soil surface. We've just sown this with wheat, and it's been sown at 10 kilometres an hour with a Morris contour drill. And some interesting things have happened. At that speed, soil from the over the crop has been thrown out into the inter-row area, and it's landed in the adjoining crop row. So we've had herbicide moved out of the crop row into the inter-row, but then it's gone over above the adjoining crop row. Not good. So if we scratch around here, we're going to see quite a bit of herbicide demonstrated by this prilled urea right over the crop row. So we've really lost a lot of crop selectivity here. Next time it rains, that herbicide will be activated, and we're in a bit of strife with this crop. We have probably stabilised volatility losses in the inter-row area though. And if we scratch around here, we'll see there's quite a bit of urea under there, and that'll be reasonably safe for volatility losses. We've got a row here, which was obviously the back row in the gang, and we don't have any herbicide, prilled urea, in that row. So this is what happened at 10 kilometres an hour. We tried lowering the speed back to 7.4, very different result. We're down to about 7.4 kilometres an hour here, and what's happened, instead of throwing it over into this adjoining seed row, as happened when we were travelling faster, this time we've thrown the soil just over into the inter-row area, and it really hasn't gone into the next furrow. So two things have been achieved. We've got minimal herbicide over our crop row, so that's a reasonably safe position for that crop to be in from as far as the herbicide's concerned. And also any herbicide that has been applied on the soil surface in the inter-row area has been stabilised for volatility losses. So we've got a covering of soil there to stop volatilisation.
After sowing in a no-till system, the ideal result would look like this, with the pre-emergent herbicide in the inter-row area covered and no herbicide remaining in the crop row. So when rain falls, the pre-emergent is activated and further incorporated into the weed seed zone, which is mostly near the surface. In this scenario, there's good separation of herbicide and crop seed. However, in the situation where herbicide-treated soil has been thrown into an adjoining crop row, there's the potential for damage to the emerging crop from either herbicide in the seed furrow being activated when it rains, or by soil water moving herbicide into the crop root zone. Now let's look at what happens when heavy stubble loads are encountered.
Well, this crop has just been sown to chickpeas at about 5 centimetres intended depth. It's been sown with a Gayson scurry till unit on 1/3 metre rows. We slowed the driver down just a little bit. This has been done at 7.5 kilometres an hour. We had a look at what was happening at 8.5, and we reckon there was just a little bit too much overthrow into the adjoining rows. So we've put our urea down, and we're just having a scratch around to see what's happened. This is the inter-row area. We can see, look, that's spread reasonably well at through the inter-row soil. So we've had reasonable levels of coverage of that in the inter-row area. There's still a little bit left on the surface, so you know, we are going to see some volatilisation there. The coverage could be better, but not too bad. We've generally moved most of the herbicide out away from the sowing row itself, and so I think that's what we'd hope for, to get good crop selectivity out of these pre-emergent herbicides. So reasonable job in some pretty gnarly conditions. That's a pretty dirty paddock harvested to sorghum just recently. Lots of weeds. As you saw when the sowing implement came through here, there was a lot of stubble, there was a lot of weeds, and it had a lot of potential for very uneven distribution.
For comparison, a Burgo 3310 PhD seeder set at 15-inch intervals was used to sow chickpea in a neighbouring paddock. same soil type and sorghum stubble coverage, but this planter was running faster than the Gayson at 10 kilometres an hour.
If we scratch around in the interrow, there's not a lot of herbicide left that we can see. Most of that prilled urea has been moved out into the interrow area. And even though we were doing 10 k's an hour with the stubble and the soil condition, it hasn't thrown a lot into the interrow, into the crop row area on the adjoining row. If we go and scratch around under here, we can see that, look, there's our herbicide still sitting down there in a pretty discreet band under the soil that's been thrown on top of it.
With the increase in stubble loads in zero-till farming systems, many growers are using low-disturbance disc seeders to avoid clogging machinery. However, many disc seeders don't result in adequate herbicide and seed separation for crops and herbicide combinations that need this for crop safety. And nor do many disc seeders provide adequate soil coverage to reduce herbicide volatilisation. This demonstration on the Liverpool Plains of New South Wales shows how some disc planters move the soil.
So I'm Mick and James Hockey's property here at Springfield, planting with an NDF single disc planter into standing stubble. We've got a single disc that runs this way and a single disc that runs this way, throwing soil into the interzone. What we found here, it's throwing soil, but it hasn't covered the herbicide properly, and we've also got some herbicide that's run down into the seed row. Now that's going to leave the seedling exposed to herbicide damage. In the interrow here, we can see there hasn't been a lot of soil throw at all, leading to the herbicide being exposed to volatilisation and not being covered. So what we'll find here is that the herbicide on volatile herbicides, example Treflan, will volatilise off in a short period of time, making it ineffective.
Another factor affecting a pre-emergence effectiveness is soil surface. Is it crusty or does it clod? To demonstrate how a clodding soil can impact herbicide incorporation, a Jenke Force 500 parallelogram planter on 15-inch spacings was put across a trial patch of urea.
Well, here we are at Berwick's in the Liverpool Plains. We've just planted this using four Jenke tines just here, 1, 2, 3, 4. This has been sown at 10 kilometres an hour, and we're in our area where we've put our urea down earlier. We can see we've got rid of most of the urea over the crop row itself, and there's been some good soil throw into the interrow area, but it's pretty cloddy. If we have a look at what's been happening, we've protected a fair bit of that herbicide in the interrow area, but we're probably still going to lose a bit of it if it was Treflan, because it's pretty cloddy. That's often going to happen when you're dealing with slightly wet soil. That usually happens around planting, and particularly in these heavier verdisol cracking clays.
Using a very different seeder, a double disc opener with no depth wheel, and at the same speed, the result clearly indicated this was not an appropriate choice where herbicide incorporation is needed.
We can see we've got very, very little soil coverage over the interrow area, so for anything that's going to gas off, have a high level of volatility like trifluralin, that's not protected. We're expecting poor weed control there. A little concerned here that we've still got quite a bit of herbicide left in the seed furrow or on the sides of the seed furrow itself. So we're also worried about crop selectivity.
These are the key factors that affect a pre-emergence efficacy. But now let's look at what typically happens on farm. After a sowing rain and first flush of weeds, it's common practice for a knockdown herbicide to be added to the pre-emergent herbicide application. Emerged weeds would be killed on contact by the knockdown herbicide, with the pre-emergent applied as a blanket to the soil surface. Sowing follows using a tined implement that strips soil and herbicide away from the crop furrow and throws it onto the inter-row area. Rainfall ideally occurs within 10 days of sowing. This activates the pre-emergent herbicide in the weed seed zone and allows the chemical in soil solution to make contact with weed seeds and their emerging roots and shoots.
Every sowing situation is going to be different, the soil type, stubble and planter. So the soil throw and soil movement will be different every time. Even if you've got a herbicide combination that you've used before, I think it's worthwhile just double checking where things are winding up, using prilled urea or another product to give you a bit of a visual indication, just to make sure that you're not putting too much herbicide over the crop row. Check the label and good farming.
If you would like to learn more about pre-emergent herbicides and their behaviour in the soil, GRDC's publication, Soil Behaviour of Pre-Emergent Herbicides in Australian Farming Systems, a reference manual for agronomic advisors, is an excellent read and available online at the GRDC.